on, lift your hands, let's sing it again. Let it overflow. 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 And let the people come from miles around as you send your spirit down. While you send your spirit down to revive your church, to revive
your church again.
Let the rushing,
like the rushing of the mighty wind.
Lift your hands, let's pray for the Holy Spirit. Let it
overflow. Let it
overflow.
Let it overflow.
One more time, let's sing, let it overflow. We need your Holy Spirit, Lord. Let him come into this room like a mighty rushing wind. Let him consume us, let him fill us, let him change us, let him work in us. Let it overflow. By my side, right by my side, here with me, here with me. Come with me, Lord. Come with me, Lord. Come and be close. Come and be close. I feel you like the wind. I feel you blowing over my face. When I open my eyes, when I open my eyes, I want to see you there. The Lord thy God, the Lord thy God in the midst of me. He is a mighty God. He will save me. Will rejoice over me.
God in the midst of me.
He will never. your presence, Lord. Come on, lift your hands, close your eyes. Forget about the person next to you. Forget about where you came from. And just desire His presence. Just love His face. His face is with us. His presence is here. Every I want to feel the presence of God standing right by me. Stand right by my side. Right by my side. You are here, Jesus. You are here. You are here, Lord. Your presence, your presence, Lord. That's what I need.
That is what I need.
Everywhere. Lift your hands. Lift your hands, church. Your presence, Lord. How I love you, Lord. How I love you, Lord. How I desire you, Lord. My flesh cries out for you. My soul desires you in the nighttime to see your power and your glory. One time, right by my side. Right by my side. You are here. Spirit, and I'm walking in. My eyes want to see you, Lord. I can't wait for the day when we see you, Jesus. But while we wait, thank you for your precious Holy Spirit who brings us closer to you. Let everyone go home knowing that we met and heard from the Lord himself. Bless our time here in your house. We dedicate ourselves to you. Pour upon this church the spirit of grace and supplication, the spirit of prayer to seek you and to find you. Wash us in your blood. Help us to come in and enjoy your presence. Teach us by your sweet Holy Spirit. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Change us by your Spirit. Touch us by your word. And we know that we will never be the same. Is not here today. He is in a place called Chiriponi. Do you know where Chiriponi is? Neither do I. Somewhere in the northern region, and I spoke to them today, and apparently there are no church buildings there. Only Yam. And they are preaching the gospel. And they'll be there for 23 days. And they'll be preaching, our prophet will be preaching every night from Chiriponi. They're going to Saboba. And from Saboba, they're going somewhere else, which I can't pronounce. But they're going where from Saboba? Does somebody know? Huh? Gushegu. Gushegu. Wow. Have you heard of Gushegu? Okay, I haven't. It's my first time. But there's a place called Kairede. Do you know where Gushegu is? No, yes. So you have to raise your hand and ask, where is Gushegu? Yes. Aha. It's in the north of Ghana. And is anybody here planning to go for the crusades at all? Oh, should we organize a plane? Oh, are you interested? Should we organize in and out? Okay. I'm sure there's somebody here with a jet, by all means. Say amen. In Jesus' name. But our prophet sends his love. And I know that his heart is always, always, always with us. And it's a blessing to have a pastor who goes to preach. Amen. And he's gone to preach. And I know that whatever, because I'm a partner of the Healing Jesus campaign, whatever is happening there, I'm a part of it. Now, it's a good time to ask your neighbor, are you a part of the Healing Jesus campaign? Amen. The answer is quiet, isn't it? Silence. That is a blessing. Let's pray for the Holy Spirit. Just lift your hands with me for 2 minutes. Jesus, thank you for your precious Holy Spirit. Teach us and guide us by your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. James chapter 4, verse 2. Amen. James chapter 4 and verse 2. Today I'm sharing with you on how to watch and pray. How to watch and pray. I'm preaching from our prophet's book. Read your Bible. Pray. Every day. All right? Are you there? And we pray that the Holy Spirit will teach us something. How many of you want to hear something from the Lord today? Amen. Hey, now I can't see you because of the... This is the first phase of the air conditioner. It's only half. Okay? But I know it's not as it should be. But very soon, you have to bring a jacket to church. This is the testing phase to see how it will be. But already, I'm enjoying the atmosphere. It's not bad. It's better than what was, you know. Oh, yes. The Lord has taken us through the wilderness, and here we are in the promised land. Amen. So there may be a few giants we have to kill and so on to enter the promised land, but at least we made it here. This is what you call Ebenezer. That's far the Lord has brought us. Amen. So we give glory to God. Amen. How to watch and pray. Wow, I have a disobedient iPad today. So anyway, God is with us. So, James chapter 4 verse 2, you lust and you have not, you kill, and you desire to have. Now, these are three alternatives or four alternatives to prayer. Lust. So some people lust. They really like a boy that they really want to marry. Okay, put it up. Put the scripture up. Okay, they like a boy they really want to marry. So they lust. Okay, then some kill to obtain for money sometimes. Sometimes for a job. I recently found out somebody was killed for food. Yeah, I read a story. Somebody ate somebody's food and it was too much. You know, I can understand. You know, sometimes it's a bit... Have you ever been expecting food and then you went and somebody has done something? And yeah, so, I mean... And then desire to have. So if you have any desires for anything, you are also being spoken about here. And then you fight. Some people fight. When we want something, sometimes we lust. Sometimes we kill. Sometimes we desire. And sometimes we fight for what we want. Okay, so most of us are fighting for a good job, fighting for a good marriage, fighting for somebody to marry us, fighting for our church to grow, fighting to be fruitful, fighting to be holy. How many of you are involved in some form of a fight? Okay, then he tells us very simply, but the reason we have not is because we ask not. So prayer is the key to having what you are lusting for, what you are fighting for, what you are desiring, what you cannot obtain. Amen. So be blessed in prayer in Jesus' name. And I believe that the Lord really wants us to go into prayer. I feel that that's what the Lord is speaking to us about a lot. Our prophet shared with us on the seed of prayer. Amen. And as a church, we must continue. I think I have to come down. We must continue. Pastor William, you're welcome. As a church, we must continue. We must continue in prayer. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, the Bible says, they continued steadfastly, okay, in four things. So there are four things that must always be happening in the church if you are going to be like a New Testament church. The first thing is the apostles' doctrine. So the apostle of the house has a doctrine. You see, although God has many pastors and many servants, each servant is a little different. That's why the Lord told Moses, as I was with Moses, so will I be with you. Because when my mother sees me, how she is with me is very different from how she is when she's with my sister or even my brother. It's completely different. When my mother sees me or my brother, what comes to her is our health, whether we are resting. My mother's always telling me, are you resting? Are you taking a break? You cannot. You are a man. You are a human being. You have to look after yourself. When she sees my sister, it's a completely different conversation, which I don't want to bring up here, but it's not much to do with health. Are you with me or are you going home? Good. So there's a way now. There's also a way that I am with my wife. Although I love all of you, there's a way that I am when I'm with my wife, which is different from how I'll be when I'm with Pastor Paul here. Very, very different. Are you there? You're going home? Good. So when the Lord is with Moses, waters are parted. But when he's with Elijah, fire comes down. It's different. All are from God, but it's different. So when God told Joshua, I'll be with you how I was with Moses, what he was actually saying, there it is, as I was with Moses, so will I be with you. What he was saying is, waters will part. That's why the Jordan waters opened. Kingdoms will be subdued. That's why Jericho fell, because Moses made Egypt fall. It's a way that God is with a man. Are you there? You've gone home. So in our church, we have an apostles' doctrine. Yes, there are other teachers. We believe in all great men of God. We respect all pastors. But here, there's an apostle. And he has a doctrine. He has a set of teachings. If you come to our church, you are not likely to hear a message on about how you are about to do something or you are about to become something. You are likely to hear about the Holy Spirit. You are likely to hear about the anointing. You are likely to hear about church planting. You are likely to hear about soul winning. You are likely to hear about the move of God. Maybe a miracle. Maybe a sign and a wonder. Loving God. Serving God. We don't talk about money. We don't talk about money. No, you're likely to hear about the cross and sacrifice and losing something. You're likely to feel somebody's tired. Yes, Sunday has not started. Sunday, this is just early. This is the preliminaries. I will go home tomorrow in this church. That's the doctrine that is here. And if you don't like it, you see, what I'm trying to explain is that that's why we have He gave gifts unto men. Because we recognize that there are other gifts that are in the body of Christ. And we recognize, like it says in Hebrews 11, that us without them will not be made perfect. So we are not complete without the other gifts that God has. That is a blessing. Bless God for them, and we celebrate. We want to enjoy those gifts. Just like we all go to Papa here once in a while, and we all go to KFC once in a while. But our mother's food, that is what we eat. And so the Bible says they continued steadfastly. Home food. So as I'm preaching from a book. I'm preaching from one of the apostles' doctrines in the church. And I will always preach. So if you are not interested in preaching, like, why are we only preaching our books and all those type of things? It's that all those things are actually an absence of the anointing and the Holy Spirit in your life. Yes. Because Jesus' first sermon was from a book. I'm adding stories and I'm giving other scriptures. But Jesus' first sermon in Luke chapter 4. Verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, and set at liberty them that are bruised. Because everybody who is bruised or offended is actually captive. Yes, but that's fine. Then the next one, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Then the next verse tells us where this message was from. He closed the book. The what? He closed what? Yeah, so he read the book. At least I'm even adding some. He read the book and closed it. Isaiah's book, he read it. The Son of God. He read somebody's book to the church and closed it and sat down. And he didn't want to add it. So those of you who don't like reading people's books, you don't want to. No. You are new. They are gone home. Okay. So they continue. That's not what I'm talking about. But Acts 2:42, the church must be steadfast. To be steadfast is to not move and not change. Steadfast. Have you ever met your friend after many years? See that the person is still the same. The things he's talking about, that's what he's talking about. The way if he's a fool, he's been a fool. If he's an idiot, have you met your friend? Say, hey, so you will not change. Yes, that's steadfast. So you can leave first love and come back in 7 years. You find that steadfast. You find that we are always devoted to the doctrine of the apostle in the house. That's number one. If you want to be a New Testament church, that's number one. Number two is fellowship. Which is that? We like ourselves. We like ourselves. Which we can over-like ourselves, and it's even sometimes a problem. But we like ourselves. We like ourselves. Sometimes I have to control myself. I like my church. I don't like giving invitations. To go and preach where? I like where I'm preaching. I like who the people I'm talking to. I like my instrumentalists. Although they are not all correct. Many of them, they need healing. But I like my instrumental. I like my praise and worship team. I like my choir. Even though some don't wear the uniform. Some, a lot of changes in the uniform. They are not, but I like my church. I like them. When church closes, the same group is always in the reception trying to meet me. Same group with the same problem. Same marital problem or school problem or beloved problem or same. I mean, when I see, I know today a girl came to me. I know that we are going to talk about this issue again. When I sat down, we talk about it. But if you're going to be a New Testament church, you have to devote yourself to fellowship. Fellowship. I have a meeting with Bishop Potassium after church. Okay, I have a meeting. Told Mother Anika what he would say in the meeting. And what? No, it will not. He will say what I think that he will say in the meeting. He will not change it, and it will be what it is. But I have devoted myself to fellowshipping with him until the day he dies and I also die. And he can also tell you what I will say in response to what he will say, and that is what I will say. So when you are in a church, a New Testament church, it's not about how I feel today. I'm sad today. I feel that you hurt my feelings. I feel they don't love me. And let's all sit down. Also, you stand for a long time. You see, I've not started talking about prayer yet. Okay. But you see, there are some people also who are like, why did you, they don't look for me until I don't come to church. How many of you have said it before? You've said it before or you've heard it before. One of the two. Good. Yeah. When we don't come, they don't love us. They are using us. Then when we don't come for a while, then they notice that we haven't come. Then they start to call us. Have you heard that story before? You see, my friends, it's only biblical. Okay, because a good shepherd, if he's good, he leaves the 99 who have been coming to church. And he gives all his attention to the one who didn't come. So it's not that we don't love you, but because we are good shepherds, if you are around and you are in church, you've come there. How are you? So are you? If I have to check on you, dear pastor, every time, are you okay? Has anyone hurt you? Is your heart broken? Have you eaten? Is everything okay? Do you feel that we love you? Are you sure? We're always reassuring you. No, then you are not one of the 99. So a good shepherd, he abandons the 99 only to go and look for that one. So if you want attention, leave. It's very easy. Leave, we'll come and follow you. Leave, just try and miss. 1 week, maybe 1 week we may feel that maybe you traveled or you're not well. 2 weeks, by 3 weeks, no, you say that a call has come. Are you not coming? Don't, when we call, don't say you don't love me till I leave. Yes. It's biblical. So fellowship, if you want to be a New Testamenter, you have to be around. You have to be around. You have to be in church. I want my pastor to see my face before I go home. I have a brother. I'm in the choir. I have a brother in the dancing style. I have to wave at him before I go home. You have to give yourself. You have to be steadfast in fellowship. Sit down. You're delaying my preaching. Number three, I'm getting to my final point, which you can see at the end there, but you're not allowing me. Number three, breaking of bread. Kufuor. Any church that doesn't have food. Any church without food. Oh, yes. Look, Jesus preached. One day he preached. He preached one of his best sermons. And everybody was tired. So he told everybody, sit down. Sit down. One of his major miracles was to provide bread in church. Food, yes. If you've not eaten pork kebab here, you've not eaten, what is out there? Kelewele is there. And what else? Jollof, right? There's some Jollof people roaming around. As you're in the church, you've never broken bread with anybody before. When I was in favor, I used to get from the kebab seller, but now this is just my way of making an order. Do you understand? Breaking of bread is part of church. Sometimes we go out to eat. Sometimes you can have a leaders meeting at an ice cream shop. Yes. Oh yes. See, when Jesus wanted to show himself, no, himself, his flesh and his blood, he needed a dinner table. Therefore, communion, he needed to set a table to show who he really is. So I submit to you that the church will never know who Christ is until we sit at the dining table. So they continued in the breaking of bread. And then finally, my which I've been trying to get to, is they continued in prayers. And so today, for just 30 minutes, I want to talk to you about how to watch and pray. Everybody say, how to watch and pray. All right, now turn your Bibles with me quickly to Mark 13:33 says, take ye heed, watch and pray. Everybody say, watch and pray. For you know not when the time is. Okay? Watch and pray. Now, what does it mean to watch and pray? To watch and pray is to be up for one of the Bible speaks of the night watches. Okay? So there are four night watches, depending on how the Hebrews have three, the Romans have four. So let's stay with the Romans. Four. There are four night watches, okay, which you have to select one. Watch and pray doesn't mean you are watching TV and praying. That's not what the Lord meant when he said watch and pray. Neither does it mean that, it doesn't mean Netflix and pray. It doesn't mean YouTube and speaking that. Neither does it mean that you are now a watchman. So like everybody should get a watchman's uniform and then you pray. Or you are watching a girl that you like in church and you are praying. No, that's not what. That's not what the Lord meant, okay? Are you there? You're going home. At the back, are you listening to me? I'm almost done. So every Christian is being advised by the Lord Jesus Christ to watch and pray. As Psalm 63 verse 5 says, my soul shall be satisfied with marrow. Okay? Satisfied. Now, let me explain something. And I just want to talk to you personally. Okay? Don't laugh at me. Have you ever been for dinner? You know, I've had dinner with the Chancellor of the Exchequer in the UK before. Oh, yes. Very important person, yes. Whoever, it just sounds like it. Yes, and I've had dinner with Jacob Rees-Mogg, if you know him. But anyway. This thing in the English government, not Chancellor Sue, that's a different person. He's here, that's a different guy. Now, have you ever been for a dinner where you are eating with an important person? And so the meat, it's a chicken, and the bone, the structure of what you are eating, makes it difficult for you to truly express what you would have expressed. Can I tell you a story fast? This one is not part of the preaching. One day, there was a farmer's exchange program. Okay, a farmer. And a farmer in Ghana went to a farmer in Denmark. Okay, for exchange, like for to learn from each other farming techniques. Okay, now when he went to the farmer's house, they sat at dinner and they were eating. And the man was served with chicken. Okay, a few drumsticks and thighs. So yes, a farmer from Ghana. So you know what happened? At a point, fork and knife, he set the fork and the knife down and then he put his hand into the food and properly conquered. Then he went for the bones and then ate the, that there's a black thing. I struggled to go that far, but I've seen people, they suck out there. No problem. That's fine. That's fine. So the Danish family was taken aback by this spectacle. So they were watching. There's a lot of high in my mic. It sounds spiky. So they were watching coolly. Then when they finished, the guy asked, why are you all? You know, when something you realize that, hey, there's an audience. So he said, why are you looking at me? He said that because in our country, where we come from here in Denmark, we give the bones to the dogs. So we are surprised to see you. The guy was so offended. Is he being called a dog? So he was just quiet. Now, after the meal, there was a salad, which was also served to everybody. So they brought him the salad, but he was offended. So he just put the salad away. That, you know, he's not going to eat this. So they were eating. Then at a point, they also asked him, oh, dear fellow farmer, why are you not eating the salad that's in front of you? He said, because in my country, we give that one to the goats. Hey, sit down. It's not part of the preaching, you guys. You see, when you go home, you say that when the father travels, the church is not, you see, because of you people. I'm trying, let me concentrate. Okay. They are going up, say, you people, behave yourself. Okay. Now, it says, my soul, put it up, will be satisfied with the marrow. The marrow of God, the sweet part of God, the part that satisfies. You know, have you ever had pork chops where the fat is, not the fat itself, but close to where the fat is, where the juicy, wonderful points are. Now, what I'm saying is that in God, there is different things. Okay, we come to church. Coming to church is wonderful. We sing songs in church. You can be in the choir. You can be in the ashes. You can preach like I'm doing. You can win souls. You can, and all that is the work of God. But the juicy part of serving God, the wonderful, soft, meaty part, the wonderful part of serving God is my soul will be satisfied with marrow and fatness, and my mouth will praise you with a joyful lips. When does that come? Verse 6. When I remember thee upon my bed and I meditate on thee in something called the night watches. There are a number of nights. When you learn how to be up, there are four night watches. The first one is from 6 to 9. And that's first watch. So some of you, when you say watch a prayer, I'm a first watcher. That's the one that works for me. Then, but that usually will not work for you. Then 9 to 12. Also not so easy, but it's also, that's the second watch. Then 12 to 3. Okay, that's the third watch. And then the fourth watch is 3 to 6. That's the night watch. Now, if you want to enjoy God, night watches, Yeah, like there are some things I don't like about serving God. There's some things that are not nice. The not nice part. Just like there's some part of the meat that's not nice. Yeah. The chicken breast. Yeah. The chicken breast is a battle. It's dry. Dry and hard. So there's some part like personally, I do them a lot, but I don't like all night. To lead people to all night, no. I prefer to pray all night. I pray all night, sometimes every day of the week. But to lead people here. I'm falling asleep. No, I don't enjoy it. I do it, but I don't enjoy it. It's part of it, but I don't enjoy it. But what is nice? Have you heard somebody doing it? Yeah. The nice part is when you learn how to wake up at 3 a.m. and lift up your hands and start to seek the face of God and to feel His presence and to know that you are not alone. That's the nice part. If you don't have it, my friends, you're not enjoying the marrow. the fatness, the sweetness of God. And it's my prayer that God will draw you into the secret place to learn to be with Him, to find Him. The night watches. The night watches. Now, let's learn what these watches are. Okay? There are four of them. And all of these watches are mentioned in Mark 13, 35, actually. When it starts talking about when Christ will come. It says, the watches are right there. Watch therefore, watch, okay? For you know not when the master of the house cometh. Which means you don't know when God's presence will come. He may come, number one, in the evening. Number two, at midnight. Number three, the cock crows around 3 a.m. And then the morning, that's when we are ending at 6. That's the fourth watch. So these are the four watches. And when it says watch and pray, it means I'm not talking about praying at 8 a.m. or at 12 noon on your lunch break. I'm not talking about praying about at break time or in between your lectures. Watch and pray is praying in the night when the sun is down and you are seeking God. Are you there? You're going home. And that, the Bible says, is the wonderful blessing of being in the presence of God. And that's the nice part of serving God. Watch and pray. So to this week, I want everybody here to choose your watch. My favorite watch. Usually I have two watches. And why not? Why can I not have two watches? Because the Bible says, and Jesus continued all night in prayer. So Jesus sometimes took all the watches and put them together and he became a watchman. May God bless you to find him before the sun rises, in the dark place, in the secret place. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. He says, he made darkness his secret places. That's what the psalmist says. Darkness. Praying in the daytime is not watching and praying. Darkness is needed to pray, to find the Lord. Now I'm teaching you about how to do it. When I wake up, what do I do? Now the first thing is that you need the word of God to pray. So that's number one. To watch and pray, you must be alert and flow with the word of God. The word of God is very important to pray because human beings don't like praying. Because it's difficult to talk to somebody who doesn't respond. It's difficult to talk to somebody who doesn't say anything. I mean, I have sometimes gone to see God and I pray for hours and hours and hours. And when I finish, I can't tell what has happened. I can't tell, as happened to you before, I don't know what I've achieved. And I wish God would give a thumbs up. Not to talk. Or say, something. To know that he has heard me when I'm praying. And so that weakness in us is first of all helped by the word of God. What does the Bible say? John 15, verse 7. He says, if you abide in me and my word abides in you, you will ask. You will pray. The word of God makes you to pray. It makes you pray. So anybody who says, I'm just going to pray. I've woken up and I've walked out into my compound. Maybe that's your secret place. I don't know. And you've walked out into your compound house and you're going to pray. And there's nothing. You're just going to speak it out. Shabalabalab. It takes a giant of a man. Yeah, it takes a giant. You'll be very tired. Just pray. Shabalabalab. Shabalabalab. You pray for about 20 minutes and you quit. Because there's no word to make you to pray. They are gone home. Psalm 119 verse 1. Help me, my friend. Psalm 119 verse 1. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Verse 2. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. When you walk in the word of God, in the law of God, you pray. So you have to introduce, when you wake up to pray, I'm teaching you practically how to pray. You need the word of God to be introduced into your prayer. How is the word of God introduced to your prayer? In different ways. The first way is through reading the Bible. Prayer and the word. Paul says it's sanctified by the word and by prayer. So whenever you pray, you read your Bible. As you read your Bible, you receive spiritual energy to pray. When the word abides in you, you will ask. So anybody who prays with the Bible prays for a long time. I can read 1 Kings. It's one of my favorite books. My favorite books to read when I'm praying. 1 and 2 Samuel. 1 and 2 Kings. Because it's like a story. On and on and on. And you can pray for 2 hours just reading the word of God. Oh yes. The Bible. That's why Paul said, we will give ourselves to prayer, but not just prayer. And the ministry. Somebody should minister the word to us while we are praying. Because it will be difficult. That's Acts 6. we'll give ourselves to prayer. So it takes a giant of a man. I like Pastor Frank. Pastor Frank is somebody I know. He can walk on open air, and he caught. be careful. He has an impartation. Maybe I don't know about him. I don't know about you. I'm not questioning you. Are you there, church? Are you listening to me? Yes. So to say, I've come to pray. I've come to see God. Shabalabala. Has it happened to you before? You know, I've tried to pray like that before. Try. I think I was about 18 years old. I said, I'm going to pray for only 1 hour. Because I read, what? Would you not pray for 1 hour? So I started. Shabalabala. Jesus, I thank you. Shabalabala. 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 Hegadeka, hegadeka. When tiredness descends on your tongues, you move into Romans 8. Those are groanings and moanings which cannot be spoken. I'm teaching you how to pray. You see, because you go to church, you'll be blessed. God is going to do something in your life. You're about to break through. The walls of Jericho are coming down. And the prostitutes of Revelation are being sacked from your life. And all the wild doors and all the beds. And nobody's telling you, how do I actually live as a Christian? I'm telling you, if you want to pray. Shabalabala, shabala. When I checked my time, 3 minutes, I couldn't believe it. I vividly remember that experience. It was 3 minutes. That's why people don't pray. Look. In my experience, most people don't pray. Most pastors don't pray. Most Christians don't pray. Most people sitting here don't pray. Now, I'm telling you why you don't pray. It says, if my word is in you, you will ask. You will pray. You have to learn how to take the Bible and open the Bible and be reading as you are praying. Oh, yes. Without that, you can't. I promise you. Hey, Baba. Hey, Baba. Hey, Baba. 25 minutes. But recently, I was reading. I was reading Mark from chapter 1 to chapter 16, praying and reading. And praying, when I see a verse, almost every verse was striking me. Praying and reading, praying and reading, praying. I started praying at 6 p.m. Praying and reading, praying and reading, praying to my shop before I realized the sun was rising. Oh, yes. And you can do it too. I'm not that type. I'm not a Pastor Frank type. You know the type I'm talking about? The type that when you're in university, like as you are now coming home at 11, he's now taking his slippers and his big Bible. And he's walking, they walk in a certain way. It's like the call to prayer. Yeah, that's Pastor Frank. Since I met Pastor Frank, look, sometimes I used to work with Pastor Frank in the office. That's the spirit of grace and supplication. Yes. We finished work around midnight. We closed it, we're all going home. He's worn slippers in the office. He's taking off his shoes, he's worn slippers. He puts some earphones. I'm showing you how you can pray for 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, 7 hours. This week you'll be surprised, you can pray for 7 hours. Oh yes, if you do what I'm saying. I say take the Bible humbly, open the word of God and start to read and start to pray. The word of God makes you to pray. Number two, preaching. There are three ways that the word of God comes to you. The first one is through the Bible, the main way. And the second one is through preaching. The word of God is preached, the Bible says. And preaching makes you pray. Yeah. You can be listening to preaching. There's a point in the preaching where you stand up. You stand up. It's like you are energized. It's like a spirit has come on you. It's like pastors who don't listen to preaching, they amaze me. They amaze me. Because Paul didn't have messages to listen to, the Apostle Paul. So he always was asking for the books, the little books, because that was the highest technology. Papyrus had just been invented. Papyrus, which is what the word paper comes from. They had just invented that you can write something. So for the first time, Paul was able to hold something and read. And that's all he'll be reading and praying, because without the word of God, you can't pray. But preaching, even when you are listening to preaching, you've not decided that you are praying. Oh, it's from the Bible. Do you remember Acts 10:44? Okay. And Acts 10:44, which is a famous verse, the Bible says, and as Peter yet spake the word to them, what happened? The Holy Ghost fell on all them which heard the word. Now, the fact that you were there when the word was preached doesn't mean the Holy Spirit will fall on you. It's for those who heard it. Hearing is very important. Because some people are here, you are not listening to me as I'm preaching. Your mind is switched off. You are rather trying to keep your eyes open or trying to text without looking. That's what's going on. So you are not hearing. Now, as he was preaching, what happened to them? The Holy Ghost fell on them. 45. Then they which were of the circumcision were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. How did they know that the Holy Ghost had come? How did they know? How do we know when the Holy Spirit has come on you? 46. For they heard them speak. They've not decided that they are praying. They've never even spoken in tongues before. But as Peter was preaching the word of God to them in the service, and the word of God was coming on them, before they realized, has that happened to you before? It happens to me all the time. It happened to me this morning. I was listening to something. I'm an avid listener of messages. I listen to messages all the time. I believe that 80% of my ministry will be gone without messages. I blame it on 80% of my messages. Oh yes, I believe in listening to the word of God. I believe that the Spirit is imparted through words. Jesus said, the words I'm speaking, not the hand I'm waving. He was waving his hand back on us. No, he was even laying hands on people. It's not the hands I'm laying. He said, it's the words that I'm speaking that carry the Spirit and carry the life. And I tell you, the day you start listening to messages, the day you start praying. That's why pastors can't pray for a long time. I'm telling you, pastors, they can't pray for a long time. I'm telling you something. What is it, 30 minutes, 20 minutes? And they close. You want to watch and pray? You wake up in the morning, you need to listen to the word. While Peter was preaching, he started to speak in tongues. He was speaking in tongues for a long time. I pray that the Lord will bless you with wonderful times in his presence. Final point, and we are closing. Books. The word of God comes through books. Daniel chapter 9, verse 2. Daniel chapter 9, verse 2. Are you there, you know? In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by what? Do you know why you don't understand how to overcome fornication? Because you don't have a book. Do you know why you don't understand the Holy Spirit? Because you don't have a book. Do you know why you don't understand church growth? Because you don't have a book. Do you know why you don't understand how to be holy? Because you don't have a book. Do you understand why you don't know how to be a strong Christian? Because you don't have a book. I, Daniel, understood by the books. You don't know how to be a good husband because you don't have a book. People assume they understand things. People assume. You know, I once wrote a physics exam. Right before the exam, they asked me if I know one of the equations. Is that day that I decided I have to stop the science? Because I said I know. This one I know about it. I don't need to learn about it. When I sat down, that was the first question, section B. You know what they used to say? Something about derive or something. You solve the formula to the bottom. What was that thing they used to do? Nobody knows science student here. There used to be some physics formula and you have to work something out. I've forgotten how it's derived or something complex like that. This one is equal to this moving thing. So I didn't understand anything. That's how your life is. You think you know how to be a Christian. So you're always working as if you know. And nothing is working. It's wonderful. But I, Daniel, I am taught by the books. The number of the years where the Lord came to Jeremiah. He was reading Jeremiah's book. That he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. What was the effect of reading the book? Verse 3. And I set my face unto the Lord to seek by prayer and supplication with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. Reading. I can't pray without at least 10 to 15 books next to me in a pile that I can't pray. I can't start praying. I cannot. I need about 15 books next to me before I can. Yes, that's the setup. I read. I don't read books from cover to cover.
No.
I don't read. You see, help me, Lord. This is a bad example. Yeah, take this one out of the recording. So don't quote me. When you marry, you find out that it's not all the things that are in the that it's not all the things that you want. You find as time goes on that you major on certain things. Don't worry. It's not all. So I don't read books cover to cover because not all. I look at the contents page. And I look like when I was reading this book I'm preaching from, read your Bible, pray every day. It is. I've been reading that book for years. I preached in your church and I preached, read your Bible, pray every day. Yes, I preached this years ago. Read your Bible, pray every day. When I look at the chapter, so the one I want. It's why people don't pray every day. I want to solve that mystery. So I don't read the whole book. I'm starting from chapter 1. No. I look at the contents page. The one I read that one and I'm blessed, no. Then I push it to the side and I brought another one. transform your pastoral ministry. Now I look at the context and say, which one am I looking for here? 10 reasons why every pastor should pray. This morning I was blessed though. 10 reasons why every pastor should pray. When I look at it, I say, I'm blessed here. Then I push it to the side. Then I bring another one. I've read about 5 books today. One chapter here, one chapter here, one chapter. I cannot pray without the books. I cannot see God's face. That's why you can't pray for a long time. But you don't even own a book. Like as we are here, the only book you have is Daily Bread. And the one we got for free. and Rhapsody of Reality. That's all that's the book in your house. And the Rhapsody of Reality is 2014. It's 2014. That's all you have. Yes. Christians don't have books. Now I'm telling you, people wonder why things are certain. Well, you have a church. Nobody reads in your church. Nobody has a deeper understanding of ministry of Christianity. Of God at all. You don't understand what's going on. So I pray for you. That's why we sell books. Today I'm launching a book. Yes, we are launching another book today. We don't use ribbons to launch. We just decide today. Because there are 27 new books. So every Sunday that I discuss, today I discuss with my students, should we launch? We should launch. We launch. That is, so we are launching. Yes, we have booked more. Sometimes a pastor will text me, how can I make my church grow? Then I wonder, the pastor who is texting me, I wonder, because I look at the book that says church growth, and I look at the question, how can I make that? I look at the book, church growth, and I, how can I make that? Church growth. Is it that he doesn't have the book? Or so sometimes I screenshot the cover and I send that. The question, is it a genuine question, or is it a spirit of Herod? Yeah, you know, as you live longer, do you know the spirit of Herod? Say no. Say we don't know. Do you know the spirit of Herod? As you live longer, you determine the spirit of Herod in Christians. What's the spirit of Herod? The spirit of Herod is a spirit that says that to the wise men, show me the King of Glory, because my strongest desire is to go and to worship him. That's the main thing that I really want. Can you show me how to get? Because that's what Herod told the wise men. But actually, he doesn't want to worship the King of Glory at all. He's just pretending that that's what he wants or that's what he's looking for. And it's in Christians a lot. Hello, be Joshua. Can you tell me the difference between the anointing and the power of God? He wants something to say. He's just trying to talk to you. But Charlie, can you help me to make? I've realized that there are certain tactics and keys that we need for church growth, and I really wanted to see. It's not true. He doesn't want his church to grow. He's not telling the truth. He wants something else. He's looking for something else in the ministry. He's looking for something else in life. And that's the spirit. If right now I call some of you and say, what's your number one problem? I want to pray for you. Say, prayerlessness. I want God to help me to be closer to him. Hey, greater love, are you there? I want God to help me to be closer to him. I want to be in his presence. You are lying. Your biggest problem is fornication. Your biggest problem is your main. It's your main. It's your bread and butter every week. It's not your. That's the spirit of Herod. Show me. I've stopped now. As I go, you know, I'm in my 30s now. I don't respond to certain messages. I just have a blessing to it. You don't really want, you know, you're not hungry for what you're asking for. That's the spirit of Herod as time goes on. So the books are right there. You don't really want to overcome your drinking habits. You don't. I've been in this church for some years now. You don't really want to stop smoking weed. You don't. If you wanted to, you would understand by the books. You would have made a diligent search, Job says. A diligent search. You would have searched to find out what is the answer in scripture. What can God do in my life? You would have gone on a search, but you don't really love God. You don't really want to follow him. And you don't really want to pray. You don't really want to be helped. That's not what you want. That's called the spirit of Herod. So the word of God, as I close, the word of God will help you to pray. The word of God will guide you, to strengthen you. This week, I want to hear people saying, I pray 5 hours every day. I pray 3 hours every day. I pray 2 hours every day. And I know the spirit of grace and supplication is coming on you. And then finally, as I close, the way to watch and pray is to follow the burdens and the leading of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit guides us in prayer. You know, what you say can offend God. What you ask for can offend God. When Solomon prayed to the Lord, The Bible says, and the speech pleased God. Which means it's not every request. When he asked for wisdom and a wise and understanding heart, the Bible says, the speech pleased God. So it's not every prayer topic that pleases the Lord. We must be led to pray, because our flesh cannot speak to God, who is a spirit. And so we must be led by the Holy Spirit to pray. Always. You must watch out for burdens. He puts, when you, as you go to God in prayer, you notice certain things that he makes you pray about. You know, our prophet describes going to pray one time, and the Lord told him, pray that you finish your ministry. You may have come to pray for something else, but the Lord leads you. See, that's where prayer changes. The Holy Spirit's work in prayer is more than just speaking in tongues. It's a lot deeper than that. The Holy Spirit leads us to pray. Job said something, I think in Job 39, 17 or 19. He says, teach us, teach me what I shall say. I cannot order my speech by reason of darkness. What it is, I don't know what to pray about or what to say. So I need the Holy Spirit. My sound is really bad here. I need the Holy Spirit to guide me and show me what to say. Yeah, put it up, 37:19. I need the Holy Spirit to show me what to say, because I'm in darkness. When I come and pray, I'm in complete darkness. I don't know. I feel like praying about my life, my money, my job. I don't know what I'm supposed to talk about or what I'm supposed to say. But when you come to God in prayer, you have to allow the Holy Spirit himself to lead you to, you know, when in John chapter 12, the Bible says Jesus groaned within him, or even in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible says he started to cry because the Holy Spirit made him aware of that which was to come. That he's going to be on the, nobody had told him, we're about to arrest you, we're going to put you on the cross, we're going to beat you, we're going to tear your beard, this is going to happen to you. But he became heavy from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit made him heavy. He started to cry because something was coming, and there was something that he had to pray about. And when you wake up to watch and pray, you have to be sensitive to what the Holy Spirit is leading you. What things that you, the Bible says, he'll show you things to come, things that you are not even aware of mentally. It makes you pray about certain things. I have been praying to God. I've been led many times, pray for this. Pray for, not what I plan to come and pray for, but you have to be sensitive to a burden. You know, all of us must seek the Holy Spirit in prayer. The presence of God is very important. You know, Benny Hinn says, if I have 10 minutes to pray, I'll worship for 9. Because it's important that the presence of God comes to lead me to know what to say. And what is even important. And Romans chapter 8, the Bible describes it as a sickness. The sickness that men have. Romans 8, 25, 26. It says, for this is our infirmity. We know not what to pray as we ought. Romans chapter 8. We don't know what to pray as we ought. Okay? But likewise, no, 25. Yeah, very good, very good. 26. Likewise, the Spirit helps our what? So human being's sickness in prayer is two things. These are infirmities. Colon, which means our sicknesses are. Number one, we don't know what we should pray for. It's a sickness. Like as I'm here, say, oh, pray. The first thing I feel like praying for is that, Lord, I know you've turned on 7 air conditioners, but I know that there are 12 in store for us. So it's my prayer that you finish up the good work that you have begun. Or maybe the Lord will ask me to pray for somebody here's salvation. Maybe this somebody's last week on earth, and you have me pray for that. So I'm feeling hot. I'll be praying about that because I'm in the flesh. But my spirit will be praying for the salvation of somebody's soul here. So it's very important for us to find the Holy Spirit's presence in prayer, to know what to say, what to ask for, what to pray about. And I'll tell you, when it comes to the Holy Spirit and the presence of God, it's something that must be sought. You know how we sing, I will seek your face, call upon your name,
Jesus.
The heart of real prayer is not willing to ask for something. If I'm honest. My points are now finished. And if I'm honest, if I'm truthful with you, a Christian who prays for things is of a low order. Seek his face. Seek the Lord. Seek fellowship. Seek communion. You know, in Luke 11, the disciples said, "Teach us to pray." My over my time. "Teach us how to pray." And Jesus said, first give the Lord's prayer. Then he gave a parable on prayer. Then he said, "Ask, it shall be given. Seek, you will find. Knock, and the door will open." Giving us three levels of prayer. The first level of prayer is to ask for things. That's a very low level of prayer. "God, give me a beloved. God, give me a car. God, bless me with money. God, I need a breakthrough in my life. God, I'm fasting and praying that you open my business. God, I tell you. God, build my church. God, increase me in the ministry. God, promote me. God, use me. God, let people know me. Look at that." Is a very, are you listening to me? Very, very low level of Christianity. Seeking. Seeking God. It's Tuesday morning and I want to talk to him. I want to be with him. I want to talk to you. Have you ever been with somebody you don't even have anything to say, but you just keep it? Yes. Sometimes I want to just talk to my wife, but I don't have a topic. So she calls it fooling. I just start saying anything. But it's because I just want to hear you talk. I want to commune. I want to be with you. Going to God in the morning and saying, "I want to be with you. I want to talk to you. I want to be in your presence. I want to hear your voice. I want to hold you. I want to touch you. I want you to touch my life. For 1 hour every day, for 2 hours every day, I just want to talk to you." Different from saying, "God, give me something." That's a wise Christian, eh? A wise Christian. You know, the Bible tells us, Proverbs 8:33. I'm sorry, this was not part of my preaching, but Proverbs 8:33, he says, "Hear instruction and be what?" Oh, please speak to me. Be what? I'm advising you. I'm advising you. Be wise. Hear the following instruction and refuse it not. Next verse. "Blessed is the man," be wise, "blessed is the man that heareth me, watching daily at my gates and waiting at the post." He's not looking for something. He's just at the gate daily. What a blessed man you'll be. What a blessed life you have. What a blessed experience of God you have. If you can be found daily waiting. I want to know what you have to say to me. I don't know what you want from me. I'm not looking for anything from you. I just want to be with you. I'm looking for you, God. I've come to fellowship with you. That's what a blessed man you'll be. Then he gives the secret to the next. Most verses are headed in the second verse. "For whosoever finds me," finds who? That's why many prayers are not answered. Hey, to make a petition to God and be answered is not a small thing. Anyone who tells you that, pray. You see, Jesus has a way of speaking. Anything you ask in my name, I'll give it to you. There in my name, no, it's a very big caveat. Anybody who's, that's why it's not easy to obtain things from God. No. If you don't pray according to his will, you know, "heareth not sinners." So if you have said, he will not hear you. You have to do that. "He that abideth in me," you have to be in his presence before you ask. You have to, a lot of things are needed to I've asked God for something, he gave it to me. No, it's not that easy. But seek him. What does he say? Proverbs 8:17 says, "I love them that love me, and those who seek me." Hey people, I don't know if you understand my preaching. Those who look for me will find me. Okay? Then, shockingly, I told you, most blessings are in the next verse. You always have to check the next verse. "Riches and look with me." Like those who seek me. Not those who seek the riches, but those who look for me, they'll find me. But riches and honor, when you find me, worship this God, if you find him. That's why we sing, where are you, Lord? Where can I find you?
You must be in this room, right by my side.
Not that you are seeking riches and honor, but those who seek me, with me. I've been honored from seeking God, not seeking anything. I've been honored from seeking God. Every piece of wealth or anything I possess and I own has come from looking for God. Because it's not easy to get things from God. It's not easy. God cares about the motive, whether it's his will, whether it's his plan, whether you are ready, a lot of things. But seeking him, those who seek me. You say, I love, God so loved the whole world. No. I love those who love me. Just like I love everybody in the church, but I married one. That's how God loves the whole world. But there are some people he loves differently. Do you love him? I love those who love me. And those who seek me will find me. Then as if to hide it, in the next verse says, but with me, riches and honor, yea, durable riches and righteousness. Then in 19, it gets worse. In 19, it says, my fruit. Because only those who see God who bears fruit. It's better than gold and fine gold. And my revenue, that's my salaries. My salaries are more than choice silver. Instead of praying for your business, instead of praying for money, I tell you, I love those who love me, and those who seek me will find me. That's true prayer. That's watch and pray. God, it's our time together. I'm here. If you speak wonderful, if you don't speak the problem, I'm here. I just want to. You must be in this room. You must be here. You must be here. You must be here. And that's why the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, most people don't understand what true faith is. It says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must first believe that he is. And that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek money. What of them that diligently seek church growth? What of them that diligently seek beloved? No, there is a reward for people who's searching and seeking is for God. God, you, I love you. I need you. I love you. I want to be with you. I came to fellowship with you. And it will cost us something. It will cost us Netflix. It will cost us YouTube. It will cost us our WhatsApps. Yes. This mature Christianity. Looking for something. We never used to give because of money. We used to give because we were blessed. But now we give so that we'll get something back. But my Bible says, I'll bless you so you'll be a blessing. We used to give because we were blessed. I want to get something from God. I want to get something. It's not. That's why Paul says in Philippians 3. The things which you once gave to me, I count but done, that I may win Christ. That's not salvation. Because salvation is not of our works. Yes, lest any man should boast. So it's not talking about salvation, because you can't work for salvation. Winning means you did something to win it. He was talking about winning the relationship, like how you win over a girl. You see your beloved, how you talk to her and she liked you. Yes, it's that to win over Christ. He's talking about winning Christ. And he goes on to explain that I may know him. That's what I was actually trying to do. I'm trying to win over Christ. And in verse 15, he says, those who are perfect, those who are mature, let their minds think like this. As many as are perfect, be thus minded. Not looking for things, but looking for God. If you are mature, think like this. Why is it? I can't lie to you. I can go into that. Whatever you pray, I tell you. But the true Christian, God is my friend. What a testimony. What a title. Abraham was called a friend of God. What are you called? Pastor, Reverend, Mr. Doctor, Archbishop, Professor, Pope, whatever title you have here in this world. What about the other one? A friend of God. A friend of God. A friend of God. And it will cost us something. You can't just find God, it costs something. You can't live normal life. That one. I promise you. I know I'm over time. I beg you. I'm closing. John 12:20. Some Greeks came. He said, sir, we want to see Jesus. As if it's that simple. I want to see Jesus. I'm looking for his presence. I'm looking for Jesus.
Just come.
You just came. And the disciples went to Jesus. Said, the people said they want to see you. Do you know Jesus' answer? Except a seed fall into the ground, that was his answer, and die, it abides alone. In other words, it can never have the presence of God if you are not willing to fall into the floor. And he used corn of wheat because when a corn of wheat falls into the ground, the husk is the first thing that the husk dies, so that the corn that's on the inside comes out to live. And unless your flesh dies, the spirit man inside cannot come out to dominate and to bear much fruit. Oh yes. He abides alone. Are you alone in this life? My God told me, I will be with you even to the ends of the earth. I will neither leave you. I will neither forsake you. I feel him in the room. I feel him in my car. I sense him in my office. I sense him on my way home. I feel him in my study. I feel him in the night watches. I know he's with me in my bed. I know the Lord is with me. God is not for me a Sunday experience. Except the corn of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it abides alone. But if it can die, if your flesh can die, that's what it will cost us something. And I know what you are wondering, what's death explaining? Jesus all explanatory. The next verse, he explains it to us nicely. He says, he that loves his life, you like your life you are living, normal, you don't want to adjust it, you lose it. But he who hates his life in this world, oh yes, it will cost you sleeping early. Yes, you have fewer friends. Yes, you watch less TV. You saw that every morning, blessed is the man daily waiting at my gate. It has cost me something. It has cost me. I can't post as much on social media. I can't reply your WhatsApps. I can't reply. I can't if I'm going to live a certain type of life. If I want to see Jesus, that I may win Christ. If I want to see him as he is. If I want to experience him. That's why we don't change, oh. That's why we don't change. We stay the same. He that loveth his life shall lose it. He that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Then he goes on deeper. It's a teaching on the presence. He goes deeper in 27. He says, 26. If any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, speaking of the presence, where I am, that servant who seeks me, who gives up this life, this world, what is all this? What is all this? What's all this? What's all this? I mean, Christians, like, we can't live without watching something. We have to live. We have to go out. We have to call our friends. Choma, you can't sleep early. Every single day, you can't sleep and wake up in the night watches. Oh, then you really love this life. You really love this life. And there's a departure. Yeah? There's a departure. God is making up his jewels. All those who don't love God, don't love his presence, don't want to be with him. God is moving on, I'm telling you. Those who seek me. What is holding you back in this world? I'm ending now. What's holding you back? What's holding you up? What is it? Which friend? Which experience? What activity? What on earth is holding you back? That's why we say, oh, let the Son of God enfold you with his
sweet and his love.
Let him fill
Let him
fill your heart so that there's nothing else left. Let him fill your heart. Then this is my favorite one. Let him have the things
that hold you.
What is
wrong? And this very life.
If only the flesh can die, his spirit
will descend upon your life and make you whole. Oh, let the Son.
Let him fill your heart.
Let him fill your heart.
And satisfy your soul.
And satisfy your soul.
Let him have the things that hold you.
Let him have the things that hold you. And his spirit, like a dove, will descend upon your life and make you whole.
Come on, lift your hands. Let's sing. Spirit, 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 spirit.
Spirit,
come and feel. you'll hear.
That you would hear from heaven.
That you would touch.
You will send your mercy.
Touch us with your strong
healing. Touch
hand.
Us with your strong healing hand.
Let's sing it again. Lord, you have told us. Lord, you have promised.
Lord, you have told
everybody
us.
Everybody sing it. Lord, you have promised.
Lord, you have
everybody
promised.
Everybody lift your hands and sing it.
That if your people will pray.
Come on, we are singing together as one church. That you will hear from heaven.
You will hear from heaven.
You'll send your mercy.
You will send your mercy.
Touch us with your strong
Touch
healing
us
hand.
With your strong healing hand.
So we're crying out.
So we're calling out to you. Crying out to you. Forgive us of our sins. Heal us.
Sense the Holy Spirit working on my heart, and I know that I need Jesus. Maybe you grew up in a Christian home, maybe you've called yourself a Christian, maybe you've been coming to church, but you know in your heart, and far from God. I'm not ready to meet my Maker. Pastor, pray with me. If you're here like that, just lift up your right hand high above your head. And I want you to do one more thing. I need Jesus, Pastor. Please pray with me. Come all the way to the front. Maybe you didn't lift your hand. You can still join them and come. Pastor, I need Jesus. Come all the way. I'm waiting for you. As we declare, you lift up your hand. Pastor, pray with me. I need Jesus. Come all the way. Walk and come. I'm waiting for you. Come. It's very important. My sister, come. Come all the way. You lifted up your hand. Pastor, pray for me. I don't want to die and go to hell. I came to church today. As you were preaching, I sense the Lord speaking to me. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. He's drawing you. Come quickly. I'm waiting for you. Come all the way. Come all the way. Jesus wants to save you. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my sister. God bless all of you. Keep on coming. As we bow in adoration.
As we bow in adoration.
Come all the way. And we stand in reverent awe.
And we stand in reverent awe.
Come all the way. The Holy Spirit is bringing you. Come. I'm waiting for you. Let your anointing fall.
Let your anointing fall.
As we declare.
As we declare.
Come all the way, come all the way. Jesus wants to change your life. Don't fight him. Allow him to have his way. Let him have his way in your life. Come all the way. Leave your seat, my brother. Leave your seat, my sister. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. Don't be too proud to come. God is calling you. Let the Holy Spirit have his way. The only name that saves is Jesus. And today he's calling you. That feeling you feel in your heart, as I'm calling you, that feeling is the Holy Spirit. He's calling you. He's working on your heart. Give in to the Holy Ghost. Give in to the Holy Spirit. I'm waiting for you. Come and find Jesus. Come and find a new life. Come and find what it means to be born again. Your life will be transformed. Your life will be turned around. Come all the way. Those of you in front, bow your heads. Church, please bow your heads with me as we pray. Everybody repeat after me, especially those of you in front. Repeat after me from the bottom of your heart. Say, Heavenly Father. Everybody say, Heavenly Father. Everybody say, Heavenly Father. I come to you today. Just as I am a sinner. Have mercy on me. Wash me in your blood. Come into my heart. Be the master of my life. Satan, I will no longer serve you. From today, I have a new life. From today, I'm born again. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Come on, put your hands together for our brothers and our sisters. God bless you. Welcome to the family of God. We have some gifts for you and a message for you. Please follow that sign right there, and he's going to give it to you. Please go this way. Please help. God bless you. As we declare, let's take our communion out quickly.
As the only name who saves, may the power of your salvation fill each heart, we pray.
And the night that the Lord was betrayed, please stand to your feet, we're having communion. And the night that the Lord was betrayed, please stand to your feet, we're having communion. And the night that the Lord was betrayed, he took the bread and said, this is my body broken for you. As oft as you eat it, you do so in remembrance of me. Today we remember the cross. How can we see Jesus? Only through the cross. And we thank him for his sacrifice, and we remember and honor him today. The body of Jesus. Likewise, he took the blood and said, this is my blood. It's a new covenant and a new testament. And it's for the remission of sins. Let all your mistakes, all your sins, all evil seeds you have sown, let them be washed away in the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Jesus. Father, I thank you for your sacrifice and the power that's released from the cross. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you, my friends. You may be seated. May the Lord give you the spirit of grace and supplication. This week is going to be a week of time fellowshipping with the Lord. This week is going to be the week that transforms your life. Every day of this week, you will seek his face and you will find him when you search for him with all your heart. Jesus' name.